So today is the third Sunday in Advent, and our focus today is on joy. And as I look back over this past year, we focused on joy a lot. It's been a theme that has come up a couple of times, several times throughout the course of the year. I preached a sermon series through the book of Philippians, and of course, the focus of that book is on joy. We talked about joy all of those weeks for 2 months. Our deacon chairman, Adam, has preached a couple of times, and this theme keeps coming up, and then that's not an accident. And so as I was thinking about preparing this message for today, I thought, well, I'll do a Google search, and I'll search for evidence of a lack of joy. Because there's got to be a reason that God led us to preach on joy so much. So I put that phrase in, evidence of a lack of joy. And what came up caused me to change direction almost immediately. There were 37 million hits with that one phrase, evidence of a lack of joy. And some of those offered advice on how to have joy in our lives. There was one book called A Quick Fix, 7 Steps to Joy and Happiness. And then there was an article, 6 Tips to Overcoming Barriers to Joy. And then another offered this, 11 Simple Ways to Find Joy in Your Life. And I thought if it were as simple as 7 steps or 6 tips or 11 simple ways. If it were just that simple for us to experience joy in our lives, why are there 37 million hits with that question, evidence of a lack of joy? And I think the problem is this, and that is when it comes to the topic of joy, it's like the old country song said, we're looking for it in all the wrong places. We think about joy and we think about it as being the same thing as happiness. But when the Bible speaks of joy, it seems to be something very different. It seems to be something that's disconnected from what goes on in our lives. You realize the word happiness comes from the same word as happenings. You think about that. You just hear those two together, you realize they come from the same root. And so happiness in our lives is directly related to the things that go on, the happenings of our lives. But if biblical joy is not connected to that, it's got to be something different. It's got to come from some other place. It can't be connected to the things that go on, the happenings of our lives. And as we've talked about joy, we talked about joy as that state of inner peace that comes from resting in God's presence. Now, that makes it disconnected from what happens in this world. It makes it disconnected from the happenings of our lives. Now, if you've got a Bible with you this morning, and I hope that you do, turn with me to the Gospel of Luke. If you came this morning, you don't have a Bible, there is one in the rack in the row in front of you. If you just forgot it and you need to use one today, feel free to use that. If you don't have one at home and you need one, take it with you. That's what they're there for, so please feel free to take that if you need it. We're going to be in the Gospel of Luke this morning. If you're not all that familiar, the New Testament starts with 4 Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We're going to be in the 3rd of those in the Gospel of Luke, in Luke chapter 2. And where we're going to be, Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 14, I have mentioned this passage already twice. We're the third Sunday in Advent, and this is the third Sunday I'm actually mentioning this passage. But I want us to dig through it this morning. This discussion that where the angels announce the birth of Christ, I want us to dig through it this morning. And I want us to see it this way. I want us to look at how the message is delivered. How this message is delivered and to whom it's delivered gives us a sense of the importance of the message. I want us to look at how it's delivered. And then I want us to take a look at what the message is. What would these angels, and they deliver this message, what is this grand announcement that these angels are going to make? And then I want us to look at why the message came. Why did God go to so much trouble to send these angels and have his son born and laid in a manger? Why did God go to all that trouble just to have this message come? So let's take a look at the passage, Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 14. I want us to look at those three ways. First thing I want us to see is how the message is delivered. Look there at verse number 8 of Luke chapter 2. In the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the field and keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. I don't know if you have noticed this, but we live today in the age of the great reveal. You know, those makeover shows, they really have changed the way we reveal news. The way we announce things and the way we talk about things is we could build up to this great reveal of everything. I think it's great though. Especially I love to see how creative people are when they announce baby news on Facebook. I love to see the creativity that comes out when they put those things out. One family, they were announcing the birth of their second daughter. And they had their older daughter, she was holding a chalkboard in her handwriting. It said, Big Sister 2018. I love that, just the creativity. Another one announcing the birth of their first child. They had one of those black signs with the white letters on it, you know, and it was just sitting on this table, and it said, Smith Family Table for Three. Just a creative way to make that grand reveal. Another family, to reveal the sex of their baby, they popped a helium balloon that was filled with pink dust. And I love that. A big announcement requires a big reveal, right? You don't announce something like that. You don't announce you're pregnant with a post-it note, by the way, pregnant. I mean, you don't announce big news like that. You don't put on Facebook, you know, oh, having a girl, yay. It's too big. The announcement requires a big reveal, some news that's that grand. Look at the big reveal that God does here. Look at the way he announces this news. Look at who brings this announcement. He sends angels. An angel to make this grand proclamation. You're going to find, he has been born to you today, a Savior, and here's where you're going to find him. God sends an angel to do that. Now, God doesn't send angels to announce insignificant stuff. And we look throughout Scripture at the things that angels have announced. God doesn't send an angel to announce something insignificant. An angel doesn't come to bring the weather report. You're watching, we don't get to do it here, but you know, normal people back in the States, they get to watch the weather on TV. And you'll see an angel flitting down with his wings. The weather's going to be heavenly tomorrow. God doesn't send an angel to announce something insignificant like that. Now, I'm sorry if you are a weather person in the Air Force. So I'm not saying your job doesn't matter. What I'm saying, the grand scheme of all of announcements, what the weather's going to be tomorrow, is not that grand of a piece of news. When God sends an angel, he sends them to announce something big. He sent an angel to announce to Mary that though she was a virgin, she would be pregnant, that she would have this son. That's big news. That doesn't happen every day. That's a grand announcement. The Bible says that an angel will announce the events that will kick off the end of times as we know them. That's huge. That's a grand announcement. That requires that level of a big reveal. A big reveal points to big news. And he sends an angel. This is the biggest of the big news. That moment when God himself is going to step in a physical way into human history. This is enormous news. And notice to whom the message is given. It's not just how it's given or who comes to give the message, but notice who receives the message. Shepherds receive the message. And that doesn't really mean that much to us here in the 21st century. You know, we live, many of us, I mean, unless you were born on a sheep farm, that doesn't mean a whole lot to you. That shepherds revealed were the ones that got this message. Most of the time, the way you and I think of shepherds is those are the guys that are blocking traffic, right? As you're driving through one of these villages, those are the guys that are standing out in the street when the 100 sheep are crossing the road. That's kind of our idea. That's about the only thing we know about shepherds. But then, in that culture, it was significant that the angel made this announcement to shepherds, that those were the ones that God chose to have this big reveal to. See, shepherds were the lowest of the low. In the socioeconomic pecking order of things, they were at the bottom of it. They had no status in society. They had no status in the economic world. They were nomads. They moved from place to place. That was the nature of their job, taking the sheep from here to there. They were nomads. With that came some bad reputation. Some of it earned, some of it not. They had a reputation for being thieves, for being gypsies, for being just a little bit off and weird. They were so low in the socioeconomic pecking order, they weren't even allowed to give testimony in a court of law. That's how little people thought of shepherds in those days. They couldn't go to the temple. You can imagine, they can't just leave the sheep. Someone had to be there. They couldn't go to the temple on a regular basis. They couldn't take place in the sacrifices. Take a look at this reveal, how this message is delivered. And there's an important message for us there. This message is the greatest reveal that's going to be revealed to the lowest of the low. And I think that tells us something significant about the message itself. It tells us that this incredible news that God became a man, ultimately for the purpose of the cross, that this incredible news is for everybody. It's significant. He didn't make this announcement to kings. He didn't make it to the rich and the powerful. He didn't make this announcement to the religious elite. He made it to the lowest of the low. That tells us this message, this incredible news, is for everyone, no matter where you are in life. He did not tell the shepherds, listen, we'll announce where the Savior is when you get yourself cleaned up. When you get your life together and you make it to the temple on a regular basis and you can do the sacrifices and do all the right things, then I'll tell you where the Savior is. He didn't say that. God brought this message through the angel to the shepherds. It's available for everyone, no matter where you are in life. How the message was delivered is an important thing for us to notice. But what is this message? What was this message that God went to such great lengths to deliver, this grand reveal? It has to be a huge message, right? That's the only reason God would have done this. What was that message? Look at verse 10. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which shall be for all people. For today in the city of David there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." You notice the first thing the angel said there? Don't be afraid. Now, I don't know what these shepherds were like. I don't know how they would have reacted to that, but verse 9 said they were terrified. And I could imagine, I've got a little bit of a sarcastic sense of humor. If I was one of those shepherds, the first thing I would have said was, too late. A little bit late for that, don't be afraid. They were terrified, and the angel, the first thing he says to them is, don't be afraid. You know, that's a significant message in the New Testament. Significant message throughout the Bible. That message, that word to us, fear not, don't be afraid, it appears 80 times throughout Scripture. Now, I've said this before. If God chose to reveal something to us just once in Scripture, it's important. He wants us to know about it. What if he tells us 80 times throughout Scripture? This is a significant message. And do you know why fear not is such a significant message? Because fear, unfortunately, is one of the biggest problems that most of us face. It impacts areas of our lives that we don't even know it impacts, but fear is one of the biggest issues that many of us deal with on a regular basis. Things like fear of the future. I don't know what's going to happen, next promotion, next assignment, this deployment, whether I will deploy or won't deploy. There's things that our future, we have no idea. There's this great cloud of uncertainty. There's fear of the future. Fear of the unknown. The what ifs, right? So you don't know what's going to happen next. So what do? You what if yourself to death and you get all worked up about the what ifs and what might take place. There's fear of the unknown. Fear of what others think. Fear of disapproval or of disappointing them. And that drives our lives very often. Fear of failure. I don't take a risk. I might fail. These fears are common. They're things that we struggle with. This is why the Bible talks about this so much. Because it's an issue that's so very prevalent in our lives. And some of you here today, you're wrestling with some of those very fears. And the angel's message, he starts with this, is foundational. Don't be afraid. Do not fear. I want us to take a look at another time that phrase is used. Jesus uses it. So we can get a little understanding of why it is the angel started with that message. Take your Bibles and turn over just a few chapters, Luke chapter 8. Just a couple of pages over. And I want us to look, I'm going to have to read the entire account, Luke chapter 8, verses 40 through verse 50, because I want us to get a sense of what is going on when Jesus uses this phrase, don't be afraid, and the significant message that is for us. So follow along as I read it, Luke chapter 8, verses 40 through 50. And when Jesus returned, the people welcomed him, for they had all been waiting for him. And there came a man named Jairus, and he was an official of the synagogue, and he fell at Jesus' feet and began to implore him to come to his house. For he had an only daughter about 12 years old, and she was dying. But as he went, the crowds were pressing against him. And a woman who had a hemorrhage for 12 years and could not be healed by anyone came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. And immediately her hemorrhage stopped. And Jesus said, "Who is the one who touched me?" And while they were all denying it, Peter said, "Master, the people are all crowding around and pressing on you." But Jesus said, "Someone did touch me. I was aware that power had gone out from me." And when the woman had seen that she had not escaped notice, she came trembling, fell down before him, and declared in the presence of all the people the reason why she had touched him and how she had been healed immediately. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace." Now, while he was still speaking, someone came from the house of the synagogue official and said, "Your daughter has died. Don't trouble the teacher anymore." But when Jesus heard this, verse 50, he answered, "Don't be afraid, only believe, and she'll be made well." You know, there's a couple of things that stick out to me about that encounter. And the first one is that Jesus doesn't seem to be all that concerned about Jairus' request. Do you notice that? I mean, he comes and he falls down at the feet of Jesus. We get the impression he grabs his robe, maybe grabs his legs, and he's begging Jesus, "Come to my house, my daughter's dying." Now, what is it that you and I would want Jesus to do at that moment? We want him to drop everything. "Listen, my daughter is dying here. Come right now." We want him to drop everything and immediately run to our house. Yet what does Jesus do? He stops and he's asking questions about who touched him. And then he stops and he has this conversation with this woman. It's almost like he's not all that concerned about Jairus' situation. He's not all that concerned, it seems, about the request that was brought before him. He doesn't drop everything. He doesn't run immediately to Jairus' house. He stops and takes care of what seemed to be some other menial matters. The second thing that stands out to me is his response to Jairus. "Don't be afraid." That seems on the surface like an odd response, right? I mean, his daughter has just died. That's when Jesus said this, and you would seem the response might be, "I'm sorry for your loss. It's okay to mourn. It's okay to cry. It's okay to be sad." You would think those would be Jesus' response at that moment as he just found out this young girl had died. But his response is, "Don't be afraid." And the word that Jesus uses there in Luke chapter 8 when he says, "Don't be afraid," this is significant for us. It's the word that we get our word phobia from in English. You know what a phobia is? CC, you can tell this better than any of the rest of us, but a phobia is an irrational fear. I've mentioned this before. I suffer from acrophobia. I'm afraid of heights. There's no reason that I'm afraid of heights. I've never fallen from a great height. I've never been in danger of falling from a great height. But for some reason, I'm afraid of heights. It's an irrational fear. There's no connection to reality. And that's the word that Jesus used here when he said, "Don't be afraid." This fear is not grounded in anything real. It's a phobia. It's an irrational fear. Now, why do I say that? Jairus' daughter had just died. This was a very real situation. But listen, he recognized something in Jesus. It's why he was there. You know, his servant comes up to him and he says, "Your daughter has died. Don't bother the teacher anymore." But Jairus wasn't there to see a teacher, was he? When one of your children is on the verge of dying, you're not seeking out a teacher. You're not seeking out to be educated. You're not looking for knowledge or wisdom. You're not looking for counsel. He wasn't there looking for a teacher. That's not why he came to Jesus. He recognized something in Jesus. I think that's why Jesus wasn't all that concerned. He seems like he's not terribly concerned about the situation. And here's the message I think he had for Jairus. Do you realize you're standing in the presence of God himself? Jairus knew it. He just needed to be reminded of that. You are standing in the presence of God himself. What is there to be concerned about? You know, so easy, like Jairus, we can get blinded by the moment. Blinded by the emotions of what is going on. We can forget it just like he did. See, that's what makes this fear so irrational. When we have trusted in Christ, God's Spirit lives within us. His presence goes with us to every moment of every day. And we have to ask ourselves, in those circumstances, when things happen, horrible sometimes things happen, God is still with me. What do I have to fear? That was his message to him. We were watching this TV show this past week, Bull. I don't know if you've ever seen the show. Michael Weatherly used to be on NCIS, now has his own show. He plays the character he plays on that show is loosely based on Dr. Phil. He's a trial scientist, a jury consultant. And there was this episode this past week, and he and the lead attorney, I don't have any idea the other actors' names on the show. I just know Michael Weatherly's on it and all the other characters. But Bull and his attorney Benny, they were defending a Catholic priest. And this guy had been accused of vehicular manslaughter. He didn't do it, but he knew who did, but he had found out in a confidential situation who did it, so he couldn't share that. And the conversation that Bull and the attorney had with the Catholic priest, they said, listen, you got to give us something. You got to give us something to work with because we're trying to defend you. And here's what the priest said back to them. He said, listen, here's what we've got to work with. I know that God has a plan, and I trust him. That's all we've got to work with, and that's all we need. And that's the reminder that Jesus is giving to Jairus. Do you realize you're standing in front of the God of the universe? I've got a plan. I've got this. That was his message to him. Maybe things will work out the way you want them to, and maybe they won't. But do you trust God enough with the outcome? Do you trust him with the situation? When God holds your future, there is no reason to fear. There is no reason to doubt. The psalmist said this in Psalm chapter 27, verse 1. He said, the Lord is my light, my salvation, my stronghold. And he asks the rhetorical question then, why should I fear? What do I have to worry about? And some of us today, just like Jairus, we need to be reminded of that. That when we have trusted in Christ, he walks with us. We don't have any reason to fear. And the angel's message was, don't be afraid. And then do you notice why he said we shouldn't be afraid back there in Luke chapter 2? He says, don't be afraid, verse 10, and then down in verse 11, for today. Because, right, that's what that means. Don't be afraid, and here's the reason why you don't need to be afraid. Because a Savior has been born. The Savior has come. That's why you don't need to be afraid. Emmanuel, we sang that just a few moments ago. That means God with us. God has come to be a part of humanity for this period of time. God is here with us. That's why we don't need to be afraid. What did Jairus come to Jesus for? He didn't come for education. He didn't come for knowledge. He came for life, right? His daughter was on the verge of slipping from this life into the next. Jairus came to Jesus for life. That's what we all need. And that's what Jesus came to us to give, eternal life, to offer that for us. For the one who hasn't trusted in Jesus, death is not an irrational fear. For the one who hasn't trusted in Christ, death is a very real fear. The Hebrew writer said, it is a frightful thing to fall into the hands of the living God, especially if you don't have any idea how that's going to work out. For the one who hasn't trusted in Jesus, death is not an irrational fear, it's a very real fear. What will happen in that moment? When I cross the line and I go into eternity, what's going to happen at that time? Will I go to heaven or will I not? Have I done enough? Have I done all the right things? Have I checked all the right boxes? It's a time of uncertainty. How can I know for sure? But the message is fear not. And it's fear not because a Savior has come. Listen, we don't have to rely on all of those things. God knew it was going to be a failing effort. For us to try to rely on doing enough things to earn his favor, he knew we couldn't do it. He said, listen, what you need is for me to come to you to offer salvation. He said, don't fear, a Savior has come. Someone once said it this way, that if our greatest need was information, God would have sent an educator. If our greatest need was technology, he would have sent a scientist. If our greatest need was money, he would have sent an economist. But our greatest need is forgiveness, so he sent a Savior. And that's the angel's message. Don't fear, the Savior has come. God is here, Emmanuel, God with us. You can't meet the Son of God and be unchanged. Your life is different, radically different. It's no longer based on fear. It's no longer based on emptiness. It's no longer based on trying to live up. It's based on Jesus' words from the cross, it is finished. It's a life in his presence, a life where his perfect love casts out fear. Now let me just say this. If you're here this morning, you never trusted in Jesus, you're not certain what's going to happen, you're unsure of what your eternity holds, would you come talk to me after the service? Let's just have a few minutes to sit down and talk about that. Ask your questions. I mentioned earlier, this is a place, if you got questions, we want you to ask them. And if you're uncertain, you look at that moment of death, and that's a fearful time. I don't know what's going to happen when I cross the line. If you're uncertain of that, would you come talk to me after the service? The angel's message was, fear not, a Savior has come. God is with us. And the angel was right. That's good news of great joy, which shall be for all people. That's how God delivers the message. That is what the message was. Why did God deliver this message? This is a big deal. God went to a lot of trouble to bring this message. Why is it that God went to so much trouble? Verse 11 through 14. For today in the city of David there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You'll find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. Why did God do all of that? That seems like it's an awful lot of effort on God's part. And you think about what people normally think about in the Christmas season. We always talk about the meaning of Christmas. And what is it that people think Christmas is? That it's a time of family, it's a time of getting together. It's a time for generosity. It's a time for us to be extra kind and extra nice to one another. But I want to ask you this morning. Is that really why God did all that? Is that really why God went to all that trouble? I mean, with the angel and the shepherds and the virgin with a child and bringing the wise men later on, is that really why God went to all that trouble? Just so we would be nicer to each other for a couple of days? Is that really why God went to all of that? Verse 11, he said, a Savior has been born for you. That's why he did this. That's why he went to so much trouble. This is not some generic peace, love, and understanding kind of message. Some generic concept of God, that we are all God and God is in all of this. This is not some impersonal, generic message. This is a very personal message from God, directly to you and directly to me. For a Savior has been born for you. This is a very personal message. To give life. God came that you and I might have life. And life, as Jesus said, more abundantly. Life as it was intended to be, in perfect connection with God. That's the life that Christ came to bring for us. Life with Jesus has purpose. That's been the question man has asked for centuries and centuries. What's the purpose? What's the meaning of life? Life with Christ has a purpose, a renewed purpose. We finally realize what it is that we're here on this rock for, after all. To know the Word, to know the Lord, and to grow in our relationship with Him. And so that the rest of the world can know what an amazing God He is. That's the purpose. Do you notice what happens there in verse 14? Other angels show up, and then there's like this spontaneous choir number that breaks out in verse 14. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he dwells. This choir of angels shows up. That's the purpose that God gives us in life. He saved us for us, no doubt, but it's not just all about us. How many of you have seen the movie Charlie and the Chocolate Factory? Either the 1974 version with the creepy Gene Wilder or the 2005 version with the equally creepy Johnny Depp. Now, I just have to question, when I see both of those guys and both of those characters of Willy Wonka, I have to wonder why anyone sends their children to that chocolate factory. Both of those guys have this creepy rendition of this character. Why would they send their kids there? But in both of those movies, it doesn't matter which one you've seen, this same character appears in both movies, a little girl named Veruca Salt. Veruca is the girl that wants everything. I want an Oompa Loompa, Daddy. I want a flying elevator, Daddy. I want the golden goose, Daddy. Veruca wants everything. And how is it that Veruca got that way? Because throughout the course of her life up to that point, which is 8, 10 years old, whatever, her daddy has always given her everything she wants. Everything in Veruca's life has always revolved, always around Veruca, around nothing else. Many times we think of God that way. That everything he does and everything that he ever has done is only for me. And we can almost get the idea, it seems that way a little bit up to this point. That God went to this purpose and he revealed this message that is for everyone. And he said, born to you is a Savior. And this is where you will find him. This will be a sign for you. We can almost get that. It almost seems that way up to this point. That everything that God has done on this day, bringing the Savior, is only for me. Everything that God does is all about me. And yes, he saved us for our benefit. That we might be able to spend eternity in heaven with him. He did save us for our benefit. But that's not the only reason he did it. He did it for a bigger reason. And that is exactly what the angels sing in verse 14. That the world would see what a glorious and amazing God he is. That when you and I least deserved it, this is what he did. When you and I were not looking for a Savior, this is what he did. When he didn't have to send a Savior, this is what he did. When you and I don't deserve his forgiveness, this is what he did. And the purpose of that, yes, it's to save us that we might spend eternity in heaven, but it's ultimately that the world can see what an amazing God he is. I imagine this was a night the shepherds never got over, don't you think? They probably told this story every day for the rest of their lives. And these were changed men. Just glance down there in verse 18. All who heard it wondered. They were amazed at the things the shepherd told. They ran around and told every single person what happened that night. And I imagine they did that every day for the rest of their lives. This night, this image was burned into their brains. God did such an amazing thing that night, they could never get over it. You know, that's really the other reason he did it. So that our lives would never get over it. So that we would be just like the shepherds. We would realize what an amazing work God has done in reaching down to save us. And that would become then our life's purpose. Like the shepherds, telling everyone that we come in contact with what an amazing God he is, what an amazing God we've met, and the difference he's made in our lives. That's what we come together here to do. To help you know Christ, to encourage and equip you so that others, you can help others know Christ. That's why we come together here on Sunday mornings. I'll end with this. There's a story of this Hindu man. He just wouldn't believe in Christianity. And he wouldn't believe it because he couldn't understand a God who would humble himself. And then one day he came across an anthill. And he wanted to study the ants. He wanted to get to know the ants a little bit. But what he discovered was that every time he leaned over the anthill, he cast a shadow on it. And his shadow made all of the ants scurry. And he came to this realization that the only way that I'm going to get to know the ants, the only way that the ants can get to know me, is if I were to become one of them. And it was that day he understood this message. He understood the message of joy, why God became a man, why he came for us. Now listen, maybe you're here this morning and you're not certain. You're not certain that you have, of your eternity. You know you haven't trusted in Christ. You're not certain what's going to happen to you. This joy that the angel talks about is not a reality in your life. Maybe that's where you're at this morning. In just a few moments, we're going to sing our final song. And I'm going to end the service just a little bit different today. I'm just going to be down there in the front row. You have a question, you want someone to pray with you, you have questions about this church or what it means to trust in Jesus, I'll be standing right there in the front row. Don't be shy. Don't be afraid to come down. Ask me to pray with you. I ask the question, settle this matter. Let this be the Christmas this year, where this finally you understand this message of great joy, and it's a reality in your life. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for this message of great joy, which shall be for all people. Everyone in this room, this message of joy is for them. It is for us. That you not only sent a Savior when we least deserved it, to pay for our sins, because there was no other way for us to be reconciled to you. That's great news of great joy. But that you go with us every single day. You give our life purpose and meaning. You go with us. You hold the future in your hands. Father, that is good news of great joy. And Father, as we close our service today, as we wrap up this final song just this time, Lord, I pray if there's one here today doesn't know what their eternity looks like, that future is a very scary thing for them. And Lord, I just pray that you would just give them the boldness. Just be able to come down and say, can we talk? I need to know Jesus. For your children, if there's some that are struggling with fear, Father, this message, do not fear. Lord, I pray you'd help them just to be able to spend some time with you if they need someone to pray with or to encourage them. They would just have the courage to come down. Father, would you just continue to move in these next few moments? We pray in Jesus' name.